Okay, so let's have another look at Tartaglia. He also proved a lovely formula for the volume of a tetrahedron. So the formula is, first of all, you have a tetrahedron. Maybe that's dotted. The tetrahedron, you have 4 points in space, making 6 sides. Let's call the points 1, 2, 3, and 4. And then there are 6 lengths, or better yet, 6 squared lengths. So if we denote Q1, 2, to be the length of the length between 1 and 2 all squared, then the formula for the volume is the following: 288 times the volume of the tetrahedron squared is 288. The determinant of this rather biggish matrix, 0, Q1, 2, Q1, 3, Q1, 4, 0, Q2, 3, Q2, 4, 0, Q3, 4. It's sort of symmetrical, so same thing on this side. And here's 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 0. So it's a 5x5 matrix formed from the 6 edges, the quadrances of the 6 edges, arranged in a reasonably nice way. So that's 1, 2 in the 1, 2 position. That's in the 1, 3, 1, 4, 2, 3, 2, 4, and 3, 4, all the 6 edges appearing. Same thing on the opposite side. A bunch of 1s here, a 0 here. Take the determinant of that, you're going to get a big expression in those 6 quantities. That's the volume squared times 288. In fact, this is in the same kind of formula as what I called Archimedes' theorem. So if you have an ordinary triangle in the plane, say with the vertices 1, 2, 3, and quadrances Q1, 3, Q1, 2, and Q2, 3, then the formula is 16 times the area of the triangle squared. That can also be expressed as a determinant. I think there's a minus sign now, though. Minus determinant, 0, 0, 0, 0, Q1, 2, Q1, 3, Q2, 3, Q1, 2, Q1, 3, Q2, 3, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1. So this is an alternate form of Archimedes' theorem. I gave you this as a polynomial expression. It turned out to be Q1, 2 plus Q1, 3 plus Q2, 3 all squared minus 2 times Q1, 2 squared plus Q1, 3 squared plus Q2, 3 squared. That formula for the area of a triangle is sort of extended here to a volume of tetrahedron, purely in terms of the 6 sides. This was also discovered by Euler. And for many years I was under the impression that it was Euler's discovery, but only relatively recently have I realized that in fact Tartaglia discovered it first. I think it's a very beautiful formula. I want to say just a little bit more about the cubic equation and go back to our friend Francois Vieta, who gave a nice interpretation of the cubic equation in terms of some trigonometric identity that really is related to the classical problem of trisecting an angle. It was a famous conundrum from the ancient Greek times.
So Vieta approach to the cubic was to look at the following formula for cosine 3 theta. Cosine 3 theta is 4 cosine cubed of theta minus 3 cosine theta.
That's a formula that first year students here at UNSW learn when they're doing complex variables. It's an extension of the more familiar formula, cosine 2 theta equals 2 cos squared theta minus 1. That's very familiar. So this is the same kind of formula, but in expressing the 3 times an angle in terms of a polynomial involving cosine theta. By the way, this polynomial that's implicit here, there's a polynomial here. This one, t2 of x, is 2x squared minus 1. And the 3 one here is 4x cubed minus 3x. There's a whole family of such polynomials for higher multiples of cosine, cosine 4 theta, cosine 5 theta. And these polynomials are called Chebyshev polynomials. Chebyshev polynomials. Okay, so anyway, let's just look at this particular one, which Vieta knew about. And so he said, okay, what we can do is, suppose we want to solve this particular cubic. To solve the cubic 4y cubed minus 3y equals some c. So it's obviously sort of taken from the right-hand side here, where c is some number. Okay, it should probably be in the range minus 1 c to 1. So let's have a look at a circle, unit circle in the plane. And suppose there's C, and we look up here, we look at this segment here, and we look at this angle, and let's call this angle 3 theta. So what we're going to do is we're going to let C be cosine of 3 theta. If it's in this range, then it is the cosine of something. And so then we look at this angle. And then we divide this angle into 3 pieces. So then this piece here now is just theta. So then we divide the angle 3 theta by 3 to get theta. And then we look at what cosine of theta is. So then y equals cosine theta will satisfy the cubic. Why? Well, because from this identity, 4 times cos cubed theta minus 3 times cos theta is going to be equal to cos 3 theta. So this y will satisfy 4y cubed minus 3y equals the c that we're starting with.
So what we need to do here, geometrically, we just need to calculate this angle here, and then we have to divide it by 3, and then compute where the cosine is, and that number there will then be the solution to this cubic equation involving C. So you can say, all right, that's good, but that's only one particular type of cubic, which is true, but it's a rather general cubic nonetheless because of the following fact. By replacing y with, say, a times y, the cubic becomes 4a cubed y cubed minus 3ay equals c. And then divided by another by a cubed, 4y cubed minus 3y over a squared equals c over a squared. So we have another degree of freedom. We can actually change this coefficient at will by dividing by a suitable a. So this gives more general cubic. Because of the scaling property. So that was Vieta's trigonometric approach to solving cubics, which is still a popular approach, and it's still discussed in textbooks. Yes?
Can not be scaled on a cubed, right?
What did I do here? I'm replacing y with ay. So I get a cubed y cubed minus 3ay. Okay, and then I'm dividing by a cubed. Oh, I see what you're saying. Yes, that should be an a cubed. Thanks. Okay, so the early European mathematicians had a lot of tools at their disposal. They now had a good number system. They had very good symbols. Better symbols than anybody had before, and they had some good experience with manipulating algebraic quantities. So things are set to take off, and the key catalyst really in the takeoff is our next chapter, the introduction of analytic geometry, where coordinates are introduced into geometry. The coordinates from a number system, so now geometrical problems can be tackled algebraically, and algebraic problems can be interpreted geometrically. This is largely the work of Fermat and Descartes, who are sort of the heroes of our next part of the story. And that's going to be the development that really allows the calculus to develop and Newton's dramatic understanding of the laws of motion. So we'll do that next time. See you then.